أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهدي الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله سيد المرسلين وخاتم النبيين ورحمة للعالمين وصلى الله على آله الطاهرين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا أوصيكم عباد الله ونفسي بتقوى الله. Last Friday, keeping in mind that we are getting close to Ghadir, I presented to you the summary of some of the important parts of the document of Amir al-Mu'mineen that he had written for Malik Ashtar about governance from the Islamic point of view. The reason I presented was not only because of the occasion, it was also to give ourselves some guidelines. Because very soon we'll be facing the general elections here in Canada. And when it comes to voting, basically based on the guidelines that we saw, there are two important things that we have to look for. One is the honesty and integrity of the candidates. And number two, the sense of justice and fairness, especially when it comes to the minorities. These should be the two, you know, guidelines for us whenever we make our decisions. Because we have to realize, sometimes, you know, we say, well, you know, what is this to do with religion? When you talk about religion, it's namaz, roza, zakat, you know, homs, khairat, sadaqat, hajj. No, for us, voting in the elections, supporting a candidate, or even standing for a position in the political system, all as Muslims, it has to be done according to the values within the Shi'i, you know, thought process. And this is where we have to keep in mind that, especially those who might be aspiring to stand up and take a position, at whatever level, you have to realize that from the Shi'i Islamic point of view, this cannot just be a personal career building issue. A person says, you know, I want to build my own career on the political scene. Now it has to come with the sense of fulfilling the duty that we have according to our religious point of view. And this is where, you know, I would like to go back to the theme, not to that document again, but few other two or three points from the example of Amir al-Mu'mineen, because this is the week of Ghadir, just to realize that in the views of Amir al-Mu'mineen, government or the political system is not an end in itself. It is a means to something even higher. And what is it? There are two, three incidents very interesting, and I think, you know, nobody in the world of Islam has presented it in that way. One is the one of very first khutba he gave when the Muslims accepted him as a khalifa. When they did the bay'at on him, interestingly, it was the day of Ghadir. But it was actual Ghadir and the anniversary of Ghadir 25 years apart. They congratulated him in Ghadir when the Prophet announced, "Man kuntu maulahu fahadha aliyun maula." And it was 25 years exactly to that day that the Muslims eventually came to Ali. That we don't accept anyone as a leader and a khalifa but you. And at that time, Amir al-Mu'mineen was hesitant. And then he gave a khutbah, which is actually the third khutbah in Nahj al-Balagha, known as al-Khutbah ash-Shiqshiqiyyah. There, right in the beginning, he says, if it hadn't been for two reasons, I would have abandoned this issue of Khilafat the way I was deprived for it for the last three times. And he talks about it. He says, number one, If people had not come to me and supporters had not exhausted the argument. Means in the first three cases, I had this hujjah in presence of Allah to say I was alone. People did not support me. But he says here, that's not the case. The entire community of Medina had surrounded him. To the extent that, Ali says, my sons were being crushed towards me because of the crowd. And then he says the other reason, if that had not, there had been no pledge of Allah with the learned to the effect that they should not be indifferent when they see the gluttony of the oppressor and the hunger of the oppressed. When you realize that the society is divided into zalim and mazloom, one is just overfeeding and the other is deprived totally, you are not allowed to be indifferent there. He says, because of these two bases, if it hadn't been for these two things, I would have cast the rope of Khilafat on his shoulders and would have given the last one the same treatment as for the first one. I would have just, left it aside. And this is where he says, وَلَأَلْفَيْتُمْ دُنْيَاكُمْ هَذِهِ أَزْهَدُ عِنْدِي مِنْ عَطْفَةِ عَنْزٍ. And then you would know that in my views, this world of yours, this government of yours, this khilafat that you are talking about is not better than the sneezing of a god. Look at the example he's using in that environment. Sneezing of the god is a disgusting thing, isn't it? We haven't heard it anyway. At least we, not the audience here. And he says, for me, your dunya, your wealth, everything, has no worth. It is not even better than the sneezing of the god. And this is where we have to realize. For Ali, government and khilafat and this whole political system, if it does not fulfill the purpose, which is justice and fairness, then it is not better than the sneezing of a god. Salawat parne ek bar. When he was traveling from Medina to Basra to deal with these rebels, on the way, his army had camped. There was a caravan of Zuwar and Hujjaj passing by. When they were told, oh, this is the campsite of Amir al-Mu'mineen, they diverted their route, they came. They said, we would like to see him. Not everybody had seen Ali in person. And so they were waiting outside the tent where he was sitting in. Abdullah ibn Abbas, his cousin, a very close person to him, who actually had the courage sometimes because of that closeness to ask things which others would not even dare, ask Amir al-Mu'mineen. So he goes in and he saw Ali, Khalifatul Muslimin, ruler of the Muslim Empire of that time, sitting in his tent and stitching one of the pairs of his sandals where the strap was broken. He had a whole army with him. He could have asked them to do it, but he's doing it himself. And so Abdullah ibn Abbas says, Ali, there are more important things for you to do than what you are doing. I'm just paraphrasing his words there. There are people waiting outside for you. They want to benefit from you. Ali didn't say anything to him. He continued doing what he was doing. Once he finished repairing his sandal, he put the pair there. And then he asked Abdullah ibn Abbas, he says, قَوِّمْهَا. Give me a value for this pair of sandals. And he says, it has no value. It's so worn out. He says, still, give me some value. What is it? He says, kasra dirham, less than a dirham. And then Ali says to him, wallahi lahuma ahabbu ilayya min amrikum hadha. By Allah, these pair of sandals, which you think is worn out, doesn't have any value, these are more dearer to me than this rule that I have over you, and the government and the control that I have over you. إِلَّا أَنْ أُقِيمَ حَقًّا أَوْ أَدْفَعَ بَاطِلًا. except if I am able to establish truth through this government and avert batil and falsehood. If that purpose is achieved, then okay. Otherwise, it's not even dearer to me than these, you know, sandals that you think has no value at all. And this is where we have to realize that, you know, we as Muslims, we really are very, very far away from the ideals and the ideas of Amir al-Mu'mineen and the way he looked at Khilafat when he looked at the issue of governance. And these are the examples that we have to keep in our mind when we are looking at such a similar situations in our own context. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to be among the true followers of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wa salam. إن أحسن الحديث كتاب الله العزيز بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحليم الكريم غافر الذنب وقابل التوب وهو الغفور الرحيم ونشهد أن لا إله إلا هو العطوف على العباد بجوده والعواد على المظلمين بحلمه ونشهد أن محمدا نبيه وحبيبه سيد المرسلين والشفيع المذنبين ورحمة للعالمين صلى الله عليه وآله الداعين إلى سبيل الله بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة قادة الأمم وولياء النعمة ومعدن الرحمة أوصيكم عباد الله بالتوبة ما سلف من ذنوبكم. To understand this importance of integrity and justice in a person who wants to go into the path of, you know, governance and political issues, let me bring one more example from his life. When he was in Kufa, he also, although he had appointed some people as judges for different issues, but sometimes he would handle some of the cases himself. And there was a case of a prominent member of Kufa, and this fellow comes at the night time to the house of Amir al-Mu'mineen with a container of honey. And Amir al-Mu'mineen asked him, what is this? Am zakatun, am sadaqa? Is this zakat? Is this sadaqa they are bringing to me? فَذَلِكَ مُحَرَّمٌ عَلَيْنَا أَهْلُ الْبَيْتِ. Zakat and sadaqa is haram and forbidden to us, the Ahlul Bayt. And he says, لا لا ذا ولا ذاك. This is not sadaqah, this is not zakat. وَلَكِنَّهَا هَدِيَّةٌ. Now, hadiyah for what? Hadiyah because I have a case that I'm dealing about you? And so Amir al-Mu'mineen says, you know, it says you really are very confused. You are trying to deceive me and take me away from the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَمُخْتَبِطٌ أَنْتَ. Are you, you know, really crazy? That is the literal translation of the word. In Urdu, we say khabtul hawas. This is the Arabic version of it. Am zujinna, or have you been possessed by jinn? Am tahjur, or are you a delusion, confused, like a drunk person? Why you are, you know, bringing this to me in that way? And then Amir al-Mu'minin says, وَاللَّهِ لَوْ أُعْطِيتُ الْأَقَالِيمَ السَّبْعَ بِمَا تَحْتَ أَفْلَاكِهَا. That I swear by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if I am given the seven worlds with everything underneath it, in my control, in my ownership, أَلَا أَنْ أَعْصِيَ اللَّهَ فِي النَّمْلَةِ. In exchange for disobeying Allah in case of one ant, that I pull that, you know, husk of the wheat from its mouth. ما فعلت. He says, I will never do that. Think about it. Somebody who has given seven worlds with everything underneath it. And the prize is only one thing. That you disobey Allah in case of an ant which has a husk of the wheat in its mouth, pull it. And this is where, Amir al-Mu'mineen say, I wouldn't do it. If we were there, we'll say, okay, let's look at it. Benefit level. Maybe I'll buy more and give to this ant later on, but I'll have the whole seven worlds there. But the issue is not to do that later on. The issue is you receive it through illegal means by disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he goes on to say, وَإِنَّ دُنْيَاكُمْ عِنْدِي لَأَهْوَنُ He says to this fellow, وَإِنَّ دُنْيَاكُمْ عِنْدِي لَأَهْوَنُ مِنَ وَرَقَةِ فِي فَمِ جَرَادَةٍ تَقْضَمُهَا The world of yours, in my view, is lesser than a leaf in the mouth of a locust, that it is nibbling on it. And this is where you have to realize, when it comes to dunya, and the governance and khilafat, Amir al-Mu'mineen never had the greed for it. He doesn't even consider it to be anything unless he is able to establish justice and adl according to the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salawat upon Ekbar. And that is why, it's not really a wonder for us when you see 14 centuries after Ali, a Christian Lebanese author comes, writes about his life, and gives the title, Ali, the Voice of Human Justice. It is really, it's a true reflection of the personality of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Let me end with one comment from Sa'sa bin Sawhan, a companion of Amir al-Mu'mineen, who was an orator and a khatib in his own right. He was the one also in the martyrdom of Amir al-Mu'mineen. He was there in the funeral. And after burying Amir al-Mu'mineen, he is the one who recited the Marsiya and paid condolence to the Banu Hashim there. And so he was there also during the early khutbah of Amir al-Mu'mineen in Medina. A very close and a courageous companion of Ali. He used to even send him to sometimes go and talk with Muawiyah. After hearing the khutbah of Amir al-Mu'mineen where he accepts the Khilafat, Sa'sa stood up and he says, مَا زَيَّنَتْكَ He says, this Khilafat has not elevated your status. By you becoming a Khalifa, your status has not gone up. Rather, you have elevated this status of Khilafat by accepting it. Means when Ali becomes a Khalifa, then even Khilafat goes up because of Ali. And this is where we have to realize, the greatness of this Imam when we talk about him is not an issue of exaggeration. He is an Imam who has to be studied in every generation, and even then people will not be able to comprehend the greatness of Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. Allahumma salli ala sayyid al-mursaleen wa shafi al-mudhunabin nabiyyina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. Wa ala imam al-muttaqeen wa amir al-mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى سيد الشباب أهل الجنة الحسن المجتبى والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء عليهم الصلاة والسلام اللهم صل على أئمة المسلمين علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي ابن موسى ومحمد ابن علي وعلي ابن محمد والحسن ابن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا الحجة ابن الحسن صاحب العصر والزمان. ما أحيا صار البدو والطغيان هادم يا أبنية الشرك والنفاق حاسد فرو البغي والشقاق. صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آبائه الكرام ما اتسلت الليالي والأيام. اللهم عجل فرج وصح المخرج واكحل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكر فتنفعه الذكرى. إن الله يعمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. الله أكبر الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله